our viewers, welcome to Bishop Mulandi today. We're going to take you all the way to Gitwe Girls High School, where we've spent a weekend with them. And many, many, many have come to the faith. We want to invite you to share with us. You're a young person. Sit and take it in. If you're a parent, listen to some of the things I have to say and emphasize them with your children. Lord, God bless you.
Praise the name of Jesus. My message today to all of you young people is titled, A Young Man of Purpose. A young man of purpose, okay? A young man of purpose. You can say a woman of purpose, a girl of purpose, a boy of purpose. And if you want to add on, a boy of God's purpose, a girl of God's purpose, you are living, you know, fulfilling. You want to fulfill God's purpose in your life. And I want to use the background story of Daniel that you, all of you know. You've read this in, you know, when you are in Sunday school, Daniel and his friends, his brothers. Because Daniel, when he went to Babylon, he was a teenager. And all of you, most of you here, are teenagers. You're a teenager, a teen in between. I mean, some people may use that and say a teenager is a young man who has no purpose, no direction. He just falls for everything. He just does anything. But Daniel, if you turn to the book of Daniel, the book of Daniel chapter 1, you will see here that Daniel was misplaced from his own country. He was taken as a captive with his friends, Meshach, Abednego. They were all taken as captives into Babylon as a teenager. And sometimes I ask questions, how did Daniel survive in a foreign land as a slave, as a captive, that he did not indulge himself with the things that were happening in Babylon? Now, Daniel chapter 1 and verse 3, and the king spake unto Aspenas, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princess, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding signs, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongues of the Chaldeans. And the kings appointed unto them a portion of food, that this is what you will be eating while you are in the king's palace. And Daniel and his friends looked at that food, and the Bible says they purposed that they will not spoil themselves with the kind of food that was being eaten there. These were young men who were transplanted from their homeland, came down to Babylon, but they were young men of purpose. They were taught by their parents disciplines. Because I know your parent, your mother, might not be going to church, but your mother prays for you. Your father prays for you. My father, before he died, his prayer was, son, I just wish you and that energy, you would serve the Lord. And today I always remember that the prayer of my dad, my father, was that I would grow up to use that energy to serve God. And that's what I've been trying to do. It's many years since 1977, and I'm serving the Lord with that energy. You're going to be a woman, a man of purpose, and God's purpose in your life. That is what Daniel purposed, that I am not going to indulge, I am not going to spoil myself, I am going to live a life of prayer. I'm going to set myself and my friends that we are going to give ourselves to prayer, and we are going to serve God in this government. That's what they did. That's what they did. The young men of today are full of emptiness. They want to have all the wealth, but they don't want to serve God. How many are coming out there and become very, very rich, and they have nothing to do with God? Let me tell you, you have all to do with God in your life at early age. This is the best time. This is the best time for you to love Jesus with all your heart. I love the young people who say, who put belts and they put, you know, what would Jesus do? You know, on their belts. And others, they will say, sold out to Jesus. Sold out to the kingdom of God. You become a young man of purpose. Don't just drift with others. Don't just go with a crowd. You know, at home, they will try to tempt you. Even here, they will try to tempt you. There are some students who will come with drugs in school. Hello? Have you heard of things they call drugs? And some of you have already started. You know, it starts with a little smoke. Just a little smoke, a cigar or a cigarette. Just a little smoke. And you cough and cough and cough. And then there's peer pressure. They pressurize you. Ah, you're going to be okay. Your eyes get red. You start sneezing. And they tell you, you're going to be all right. The next one is going to be better. And you try it again. And then you try it again. And they encourage you because peer pressure. Live above that peer pressure in the name of Jesus Christ. Live above that because you are a woman of God's purpose. You are a man, a young man of God's purpose. And you're going to make it, praise the Lord. And so this is what this servant of the king said, oh, no, we can't do that. We cannot feed you with other food other than what the king has set out for you. He said, you allow us just to eat boiled vegetables. And after so many days, let us be, inspected. And after so many days after eating that food, these fellows looked smarter, looked beautiful. They looked handsome. They looked smooth, skin, you know, after eating even boiled vegetables. Doesn't matter what you eat. You can come out. You can come out beautiful. Some of you young people at your age, you're so concerned about beauty. All right? Let me tell you, youth and beauty fade away. But character endures forever. It fade away. The youth and beauty will fade away. But character that is built around God, that has made choices and the right choices in life, that character will endure forever. Amen? That is what is going to remain here. Some of you, when you go to the university, immediately you enter there. Boys are lined up. I'm talking to the girls now. Boys are lined up checking you out. And, ako, you know? And very soon you are lined up with boys here. You tell them, I'm not of that type. I am not of that type. I am going to go through university without indulging myself in that stuff that you call, come, we try. I'm not going to try it. I've tried Jesus. He satisfies me. Praise the Lord. So one day that daughter of mine told me, Dad, I found a guy. And I think you will like him. Really? I want to see. Really? And you know, when I met that guy for the first time, he just looked like me. I had to go to the mirror to check myself again. You know, yeah, I think that, and he just behaves like me. Except he's not preaching like me, but he's a good guy. He's a good guy who got my daughter. And I'll never forget that day, girls. Let me tell you, I'll never forget that day that I escorted my daughter up to the edge of the house at the door, and I opened the door. She was wearing white from up here all the way. I held her hand and I said, now go and become a tribe. I blessed her at the door as she left for her wedding on that day. And I laid all the blessings and said, from you many children will come forth, and a great nation, your nations will come out of you. A great tribe. I'll never forget that. I said, a great tribe will come out of you. And she was standing there, and I saw some tears, you know, come down. I'm leaving my dad. But I gave her away to a loving man who took her. Don't make shortcuts, girls. Get out there. Don't make shortcuts. Yes, wait for that day when your dad will walk you out on that door and give you to a loving man. Boys, do you hear this? When a mzee will give you a girl. I'm talking about this because I know you dream about that. You're always dreaming about that. Those days when the letter would come, when we the letters would come from the from wherever post office, and they are called out there, and I'll see boys with a torch inside a blanket reading a letter. And of course you could see outside, you know, there is a torch here, you hey buana. And you know what those letters would say? I love you like sweet. I love you like a chewing gum. I love you like. I don't know what they tell you these days. I can't speak your language. Oh, I'm told here, as they call one of the bear. Even it's out here, condo. Now, at they call you babe. Babe. Ni babe, kana ni doi, ni babe. B. Bear. Ah. You know, there's that time that will come for that relationship to begin at the right time. Leave it to God. God will lead you to the best person, the best woman, if you have kept yourself. Give me an amen. Let me run quickly. I just can't finish there. You know, let me run quickly to chapter 2 of Daniel. Chapter 2 of the book of Daniel. There's one portion there that I just have to go over. Daniel and his friends grew up. They were very, very prayerful. In chapter 2, the Bible tells us that Nebuchadnezzar, the second year of Nebuchadnezzar, he had a dream. He had a dream, and when he woke up in the morning, he forgot what the dream was all about. And so he called, let me just tell you briefly. He called all the wise men and the dream interpreters. He called them into the palace to come and interpret the dream to Nebuchadnezzar. When they came, the problem was there were two problems. One, the dream, he didn't even know what he dreamt. And second, the interpretation. So he said, tell me the dream, and then tell me the interpretation of the dream. And they just say, King, no one. No, it's only you who dreamed, and it's only you who know. We don't know. And they joked around, he threatened them. He told them, I will kill each one of you if you don't tell me the dream and the interpretation thereof. And the king issued a decree that he was going to kill them if they don't tell the dream and the interpretation of the dream. That was a big problem. But there was a group of guys who had God's purpose in their lives. There was a group of guys who had God's purpose in their lives. They were men of prayer. They waited on God. They read words, God's word. They read, they kept it in their hearts. And one of the men, the servants, remembered Daniel. And he went to Daniel and said, Daniel, we have a problem. We have a problem here, Daniel. All these soothsayers and whatever, all these guys are going to die if we don't tell the king the dream and the interpretation thereof. He said, is that a problem? Just give me time. Give me time. This guy was deep. This guy was deep. I'm calling upon you young men and women to be deep spiritually. Quit being shallow. Dance here and then you go and do whatever. I want you to be deep in the spirit, deep in the things of God. Daniel says, we are going to pray. And so at night, the Bible says that Daniel went and called his friends and they went to pray. And as they prayed, God gave the dream to Daniel. He also gave him the interpretation. But I want you to note a number of things. And I'm going to go over those verses very briefly here. Verse 19, chapter 2, verse 19. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. In a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and mighty are his. And he changes the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. Verse 22, he revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. I thank thee and praise thee, O God. This guy was not a 1 minute prayer. This guy was deep in prayer. This guy, when it came to praying, he was deep. He sought the Lord until God came around and he answered. And he begins to praise the Lord. And I'm calling upon you, young men, if you're going to survive this generation, you got to be deep, a man, a woman of prayer. A man, a woman of prayer, you will survive during these days. These are very dark days, my friends. Dark days politically. My friends sitting here have told me what is happening in the countries. They've told me what is happening in the continent of Asia. India, what is happening there? Kenya, God is here in Kenya. And God is doing something in Kenya. Just by the few little skimches here and there, that is nothing compared with what our friends are going through. God is in this country of ours, Kenya. And if your purpose in your heart to live God's purpose, you're going to see God is going to go with you all the way to the top. Yes, all the way to the top. Let me tell you, we need to go all the way to the top morally. We need to be morally, you know, upright and choose things according to God's conscience, God's spirit. Choose things according to that. But a lot of young people, a lot of people in the land, you know, they like to be successful, but they have nowhere to base their success. It's like a man who puts a ladder on a very questionable wall, and he climbs up that ladder of success only to come down. You must base your ladder on a strong place. Hold it carefully so that you can climb. I like milk. Milk, if you boil milk and you leave it to sit to get cold, what happens on top? You don't tell the cream to come on top. It comes up automatic. I like that. When you are morally upright, when you are based your faith on the word of God and you're spiritually minded, you will come up like cream and go to top, whether they like it or not. Yes? I know a lot of you are fearing, I'll go to the university. There are no jobs out there. I will do ABCD. There are plenty of jobs. We have yet to make satellites and throw them in the sky. We need engineers that need to do that in Kenya. We haven't had nuclears, as you know, out here in Kenya. We need engineers. That is just a little bit. All right? Kenya can feed Europe. Kenya can feed Europe with agricultural produce here. You're going to give me an amen? So we need agricultural workers who are very, very serious. We can do it in the name of Jesus Christ. We can feed the world from this little country. Yes, we can. But the engineers are seated here. The agriculturists are seated here. The directors are sitting here. The CSS are sitting here. Now listen. Daniel is called upon to interpret. He goes and he sleeps, praying, wakes up in the morning. He knows the interpretation and he comes to the king and he said, "Oh king, it is not me. It is him. It is him." Amen. It is him who has given me the dream plus the interpretation. Let's just read a few verses here before we close. Verse 24. Therefore, Daniel went in unto Arioch, whom the king had ordained to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and he said thus unto him, "Destroy not the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show unto the king the interpretation." Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste, and said thus unto him, "I have found a man of the captives of Judah, that will make known unto the king the interpretation. Hear this. The captives of Judah. This guy is a captive in this country. He's a captive, but his spirit is not a captive. He's a captive, but his spirit is not a captive. His spirit is not captive at all. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name are you? Whose name was Belshazzar? I'm sure he must have asked him, what are you? Oh, I said, I'm so and so. Then verse 27, Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers, show unto the king. He first of all lays it and says, that cannot be shown by any of these guys. But a guy who is connected to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, my God. Young men, listen, you need your God. You need your God today in this culture. This is a tough culture. You need a God. Not one of the 330 million from the other continent, but you need a living God. You need a God that you will entrust your life. You say, God, take my life. Today, I want you today that you give your life to Christ and tell him, Christ, take this life of mine. Use it, Lord. Use it, Lord. If you can use a fellow, I don't know where you come from. I don't know, and I don't care where you come from. Because where I came from, you don't want to know. You don't want to know the family where I grew up. You don't want to know. I went to class 1 at 15 years of age. And you think I had a chance? I didn't have a chance. Can you imagine a 15-year-old, a teenager in class 1? That was me. That was me. We were born, 9 of us. I was in the middle. Some of my brothers, you know, went up to, you know, class 6 and they left school. And when I went in, I just kept on. I got disillusioned. I ran away from school. It's a long story, but later I went back to school and continued. The Lord has been very good. The Lord has been very, very good. Otherwise, I didn't have a chance. I didn't have a chance. And let me tell you today, when I look back at my siblings or my brothers and my sisters, I have many regrets. I wish that they, you know, they would have turned around, give their life to Jesus Christ. I preached to them. I prayed for them. But my brother would not turn around. He went on and on and on. And he got so depressed. One December, we were going to celebrate Christmas. One December, we were going to celebrate Christmas, and he did not show up. He had a big family. He didn't show up. He had been lost for months. We didn't know where he was. And we had a word from the chief around that they had found bones, skeletons of a grown-up man. And when we went there, we found some things, some clothes, pieces of clothes and a bag to indicate that it was my brother. My brother hanged himself. He took his life. There was a rope up there. And you could tell he had hanged himself. Depressed, drinking, he couldn't stop. Let me tell you, young man, don't try any of these things. Don't try any of these things. You will end up bad. I have live examples, real examples. My brother, that's what happened. Telling you these stories because they're real. And when I remember them, I just want to preach to you because I want to love you. I want to love you so that you don't go that way. I don't want you, young man, young woman, to go that way. No, I don't want. I mean, when I look at some of those people that had a chance. You have a chance. You have a chance of living in God's purpose. You have a chance of being a child of God. You have a chance of being a prayerful woman. I have all those many stories, and yet I can tell you, I've also seen young men. Young men who cleaned up. Young men who said, I will not go that way. I will go the way of God. In my village, there are young men. We were saved almost, you know, together. And they chose to be witnesses of the gospel. And today they are ministers. And their families are mighty, mighty families filled with the power of God. And I said, that's a way. Young men, come the way of Jesus. Come the way of God. Come the way of faith. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These guys were young men of purpose. These young men were filled with a deep sense of God's presence. They lived close to God, and their prayer was powerful. We have no time to look at one of the chapters there. When they were tempted that they would be thrown at the fire, they'd be thrown. And they said, we're not careful, King. Whether our God will save us or not, we will not worship your God. Where are we, young men, to decide we worship the living God while in high school? God, you paved the way of men like these ones who are preaching to us. That's why we came. We came as examples for you, young men. And so you are people you can look up to. If you made it, I can make it. Doesn't matter the village where you come from, how poor your family is, God is going to pave a way for you. You are here for a great purpose, and that is God's purpose. God wants to do something in your life to transform you, for you to be focused on the things of God. You will never go wrong with that. You will never, never go wrong with that. It is time for you, even if you've been saved again and again, but you feel, there are things that you've been indulging in. In school, there's so many things. You've been told. And these begin slowly, slowly by slowly, and very soon, by the time you come out. Man, you have an open sky. You can be all that God has in mind for you to become. You can be a God-fearing woman. You can be a God-fearing young man. That's why we came here. We love you. I want you to be successful, because my prayers and my preaching and the instructions of your teachers who want the best in your lives, you can make it. With all these, you can't go wrong. You can't go wrong. There's something that God is doing. There's a movement. There's a move of God in our schools. And God wants an army in Kenya of young people who are in the faith of God. Young men who are filled with the Spirit of God. Young men who are, you are sharp and deep in the things of God. And so today, I just want to pray with you as you make that very strong and serious decision. You want God in your life. You want Jesus in your life. You want life eternal in you. You just want it all. You're tired of joking around. You are purposed. You're going to be a God purposeful young man. It is today. It's not an accident. It can be that. You can be that young man. You can be that girl. You can be that young man. Yes, I want to invite you tonight
to Jesus.
I want to invite you to Jesus.
I surrender all to Him. I freely give.
Viewers, that is our rally today at Gitwe Girls High School. We've had a blast. Parents, as I do these missions in schools, even at my age, I just want to invite you to invest in this work. Call the number on your screen and please tell us you're praying for us. Get a prayer group from your church, because even as they get saved, they might remain saved. It's very easy for them to fall back. So pray with us and support this work if you can. Get that number. Ask how you can get involved with your resources, and we will be so glad. Otherwise, thank you for being with us on this rally. Pray for us, and God bless you very much.